Mr. Taru. Alright, today we're going to take a look at a video about transformations. Specifically, we're just going to pick apart this parent function of y equals the square root of x. So, we're going to take this parent function, y equals the square root of x. Let's just find out what this function looks like as it sits right now. Well, if we make a t-table of this value and take some values of x and y like 0, 4, 9, and 16, let's see what that looks like graphically. Now, I'm going to do a t-table with perfect squares because when I take those values and plug them in for x, that's exactly what I'm going to do with them, is square root them. So why not pick a number that I can graph easily? And I don't think I'm going to have an x value of 16 in this tiny little chart, but we'll go along with it anyway. So if I plug in 0 for x, I get the square root of 0, which is 0. If I plug in 4, I get the square root of 4, which is 2. If I take 9 and plug it into this for x, the square root of 9 is going to equal 3. And not that I'm going to be able to graph an x value of 16, but if I take 16 and plug it into this square root function, I get the value of 4. So this is going to look like 0, 0, 0, tick marks out of the way. There you go. 0, 0, 4 over 4 and up 2, over 9 and up 3, so 1, 2, 3, 4, 5, 6, 7, 8, 9, and up 3. And here we have our parent function y equals the square root of x. Now, I don't want to do a t-table every time I draw a different graph, at least not if I'm doing graphs that I'm already familiar with. Like, if I want to graph y equals the square root of x minus, let's say, minus 2, then this plus or minus, when you have a plus or minus at the end of your equation that's outside the function, in this case my function is the square root symbol, that is a vertical shift. If it's plus 2, you'll move up, but in this case, because it's minus 2, we're going to move down. So each of these individual points that I just plotted a minute ago, I'm going to move down two places because of this minus 2 and redraw my square root function, shift it down two places. So plus or minus at the end of your equation, outside or after the function is over with, that is a vertical shift. Now what if I wanted to make this graph, y equals the square root of x minus 2. Well, a minus 2 at the end or outside your function is a vertical shift, either up or down. If you have a plus or minus inside your function, inside, in this case, my square root symbol, that's a movement left or right. Well, when it's minus 2 inside the function, that is a shift to the right two places, not to the left two like you might think because of subtraction, but to the right two. So if I were to plug in, let's say, well, let's do a little t-table here. If I attempted to just use sort of like a set of generic values, such as 0, like this graph originally starts at 0, if I try and plug in 0, I'm at 0 minus 2, which is negative 2. And see, you can't square root a negative 2. You can't square root a negative number. You can only square root a positive number. So if I put in a value of 2, well, if I plug in 2, 2 minus 2 is 0, and the square root of 0 is 2. So you see how that point is at 2, 0, where it used to be at 0, 0. So I'm going to come over here, 2, 0, make a point. And if I'm going to put in, let's say, I want to put in 6. Now, why would I want to put in 6? Because you can't square root 6. Because the first thing you're going to do with that value is subtract 2. So 6 minus 2 is equal to 4. Oh, so the square root of 4 is equal to 2. So where originally my point was at 4, 2, now to get that same point, I got to move over to 6. And 6 minus 2 is 4. And so that becomes the value of 2. So if I plug in 6, 6 minus 2 is 4, and the square root of 4 is equal to 2. So this graph, see these points are moving over two places to the right. So again, if you've got a minus 2 inside your function, that is going to be a shift to the right. if it were y equals the square root of x plus 2, that would be a shift to the left. Okay, let's take a look at another equation. And let's say I want to graph y equals negative square root of x. If your graph starts with a negative in front of the function, that is a reflection over the x-axis. So let's look at these original points, this original white graph. My original graph, my paired function, y equals the square root of x, at 0 is 0. So if I plug in 0, I get 0, and the square root of 0 is 0, and then a negative, and that doesn't change anything. Now, my other parent function at 4 gave me an answer of 2. Well, if I plug in x equals 4, the square root of 4 is 2, but now that negative out front is going to change my y value from being 2 to giving me a y value of negative 2. And you start to see the pattern here? The graph is reflecting over the line or the axis, the x-axis. And if I go to my other point that I used for my parent function, my white function, at 9, the square root of 9 was 3. Well, if I plug in 9, I still get, of course, the square root of 9 is 3, but now it's got a negative out front. So what was a positive 3 is now going to become negative 3. So if I have an equation, or if I know my parent function, and I have an equation with a negative sign in front of the function, that is going to reflect it over the x-axis. And so what was above the x-axis is now going to be below the x-axis. Alrighty, now what about if we take, well, I think I can squeeze this up here. Let me put that back up there. How about if we take the last one here before I move on to another example of y equals the square root of negative x minus 2. So I'm going to go look at this blue graph here and compare these two. How does y equals the square root of negative x minus 2 compare to the equation of y equals the square root of x minus 2? Well, this negative in front of the x is going to reflect the graph over the y-axis. So what was x minus 2, what was starting at the value of 2 and going to the right, what did have a horizontal shift of 2 to the right, now with this negative out front, that negative out front of x inside the function is going to reflect it over the y-axis. So instead of this point being at 2, 0, like it was here, now my point is going to be at negative 2, 0. With my blue graph, because I'm comparing the red with the blue, see they're almost the same thing except for the negative in front of the x that's inside the function. What was at 1, 2, 3, 4, 5, 6, 2 is now going to be at 1, 2, 3, 4, 5, negative 6, 2. And then what was at 11, 3 is now going to be at negative 11, 3. 1, 2, 3, 4, 5, 6, 7, 8, 9, 10, 11, 3. So if you have, again, just your parent function, a plus or minus at the end of that function is a vertical shift. A plus or minus inside that function is a horizontal shift. If you have a negative in front of your function, that's a reflection over the x-axis. And if you have a negative in front of x that's inside the function, maybe an absolute value function, in this case a square root function, that is going to be a flip or a reflection over the y-axis. So there you got a nice little graph of spaghetti strings here. Let's summarize that in one final statement. Okay, so we have y is equal to plus or minus a. If you have a negative, that's a reflection over the x-axis. If your a is greater than 1, that is a stretch. And if A is less than 1, that's actually going to be a compression. I didn't do any of those as an example. I'll do a stretch here in a second. And then we got this idea of F. Now, if your textbook is using that notation, F is not a variable. F is a function. The function in all those examples I just did was the square root symbol. So this might be a set of parentheses with a power of 2, like a quadratic, or even absolute value symbols. And inside that function, you might have a plus or minus in front of the x. If you do, that is going to be a reflection over the y-axis. And then you might have a plus or minus c. And if you have that plus or minus, again, inside your function, then that is going to be, if you see x plus c, that is a shift to the left. And if you see x minus c, that's a shift to the right. So plus or minus inside your function, that's a movement left or right. And then finally, you might have a plus or minus d, which is going to be your vertical shift. Okay, so there's sort of like a summary statement. You might actually also have a coefficient in here. My textbook doesn't deal with those until we get to trig functions. And if you have a multiple of something other than 1 in here, that's a horizontal stretch or compression, but I'm not going to deal with that until my trig function, so that's a couple of chapters away. All right, woo! One last example. Now, when you're graphing, say, something like a parabola, just a parent function parabola, y equals x squared, might look something like this. Whereas if you've got something like y equals 2x squared, that 2 is a vertical stretch. If a is bigger than 1, it's going to pull the graph up. And with parabolas, because they go up indefinitely, it makes them look like they're skinnier. That can lead you into a little bit of trouble, though, with some of your more interesting graphs that you might have to do, say, in a pre-calculus book. A vertical stretch does not really make a graph skinnier. Let me show you what I'm talking about. If I give you a graph that's just a couple of few line segments, such as this, and we're going to call this function f, and now I want function g to equal 2 times f of x. So I want to put a vertical stretch on this function f to create function g. Well, that's going to take all the y values and multiply them by 2. Okay, so let's take a look at this. This y value has a y value of 0, so when I stretch it, it's still going to be 0. 2 times 0 is 0. Whereas at this point, if I stretch this y value, I end up here, and I get this sort of increased slope on the sides of the graph, like we see with the parabola, but I'm fixing the sides, so hopefully I kind of hide this idea of it or show that it's not really getting skinnier. All these y values here are going to get twice as tall, and so you get a graph that's, well, twice as far away from the x-axis, but you see how you don't see that sort of skinny and sort of optical illusion that you get with a parabola. And then finally we come down to this y value of 0, and that's going to come down, and again, 0 times 0 is 0. So I've increased the slopes of my sides. I've made my graph twice as tall with the stretch, but you can see with those ends being tied down that I'm not really actually making the graph skinnier. I'm making it taller. That you do not see in a parabola because they go up forever. That is transformations. I hope this video helps. Bam!